and then 11, then 13. So not too bad, not too bad. I was telling some of you that if you, after this you train, maybe you can also join that, okay? Later at the end of the lectures, I will talk about it. Right, so it's 10 o'clock, good morning. And of course, this is the last lecture of this semester, week 13. Right, so last week we stopped here after talking about two conflict resolution methods. Okay, one is called separate chaining, where you put all the conflicting or colliding key in the same home address but in a linked list. That is separate chaining, okay, the first method. The only concern there is when you put too many keys into the same linked list, then you will not get this O1 complexity for the tree operation. So therefore, you have to use a load factor to actually control it. Right, for separate chaining, the load factor need not be less than 1. It could be greater than 1, okay? And we are using the load factor to decide how many nodes you can put inside one linked list. Right, so for example, you might say the load factor is equal to 5. Okay, for separate chaining. Right, so this load factor can be more than 1. Okay, so we are using this to decide when to do rehash. Okay, meaning that if it is too full, then we have to rehash so that the linked list becomes shorter and you don't suffer from this problem with O(n) complexity when you do search, when you do insert, when you do delete. Yeah, so normally you can actually say load factor can be equal to 5 for separate chaining. Right, so the idea is if I have, like for example, 11 table size, right? If you say load factor equal to 5, it means that maximum, if you are so lucky, that you really distribute them equally into the table, you will have 55 value inside that, meaning that each of this linked list has 5 elements. Okay, once you try to insert another node into this linked list with 5 elements, you cannot allow to continue. You should rehash, meaning that you have to take everything out of this table, extend the table size, and then rehash it into the new table. Okay, so that is the idea about separate chaining. You can actually have load factor greater than 1. Okay, for the other, you also most of the time you want to control it such that it is actually less than 0.5. Okay, then we talk about linear probing. Linear probing is again very simple. You just go to the next slot. If this slot, the home address is occupied by someone else, you just go to the next slot to find the empty slot. Okay, and then you just put it there. Yeah, so very easy to resolve the collision, but something that's easy always have problem, right? So therefore, when you try to do that too often, you are going to find all the nodes, all the values are clustered together. So if the next one is home address is 0, you have to go through all the n elements in order to find the empty slot. So this is what we call the primary clustering problem, right? And you actually render this to become O(n). Insert, delete, and search all become O(n). So this is no good. Right, so they try to improve it by multiplying a factor, d, such that there's a gap in between. Okay, but again, it will not solve the problem because you still need to follow this pattern. All the keys that go into the same home address will have to jump this same gap that you impose. Okay, so you still follow the same path, right? So people actually take out a new way to do it. So instead of saying, okay, multiply by 3, so you go 3, 3, 3, 3, you will try to change the gap so that you maybe have a different gap. Okay, so that those keys that have to use the next home address are not going to be affected by the previous key, something like that, yeah? So in this case, you can see that this hash key is what we call the home address. The quadratic probing is saying that I have to do one square, meaning that if the home address is occupied, I just go to the next one. And if it's occupied, I go back to the home address, I plus two square, which is equal to four. And again, if it is occupied, I go back to the home address, and then I plus three square, which is nine. So remember, quadratic probing is you have to go back to the home address and then add. Okay, add one, add four, add nine, add 16, and so on. Okay, don't go and continue adding from where you stop. If you do that, then it's wrong, yeah, because it's home address plus one, home address plus four, home address plus nine, yeah, and so on. But of course, if you have to do it too often, you don't want to go all the way back to the home address because one to four is three, four to nine is five, nine to 16 is seven, and so on. Yeah, so you can actually start from where you stop and then just add the next odd number, right? If you're confident in doing that. Okay, so that's how the quadratic probing is used to resolve collision. Take example. So I have already inserted 18, now I want to insert 3. Table sign is 7, so 3 mod 7 is equal to 3. So you just go there and put the 3 inside there, very simple. Right, now I want to insert 38. 38 mod 7 is again 3. Right, so this is a home address and it is occupied by 3. So you have to go to the next one, add 1, and it is occupied again. So you go back to the home address and add 4. Yeah, you go back and add 4. Right, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4. So therefore, 38 go inside here. Okay? Right, so you just continue to add things inside there. But quadratic probing is supposed to solve the problem of linear probing. Okay, but actually, quadratic probing introduces two problems by itself. Okay, so we want to look at the first one first. So it said that if there's this theory of quadratic probing, if the load factor is less than 0.5, and at the same time, if the table size is a prime number, then we can always find an empty slot. Meaning that if these two conditions are met, you can always find the empty slot. Okay? Right, so this one is. However, if you have load factor greater than 0.5, then you might face a problem. Meaning that you cannot find the next empty slot, even though there are a few more. Right? So for example, you say first of all, you insert 12, and then after that, you try to insert 10. Okay, so insert 12 mod 7 is 5, right? So 12 go inside here, no collision. Now you try to insert 10 mod 7 is 3, right? So this is a home address, you add 1, occupied. So from here we try, add 3, 1, 2, 3, it's occupied. From here you add 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, occupied, you from here add 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Occupied, you add 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Add 11. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Add 13. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 13, right? Yeah. Then you add 15. You all go and have a cup of coffee, then I'll continue. You can never find the empty slot, even though at the moment there are 3 more slots. Okay? Because table sign is 7, and you have 4 inside there, which is greater than 0.5. Can you understand this? So quadratic probing has this problem. Yeah? And you have to make sure that your load factor is less than 0.5. Otherwise, you can suffer from this problem and your program cannot stop. You cannot find the empty slot, okay? So be careful about this. So therefore, when this happens, when you have already have this, what you need to do? You have to rehash. You have to expand the table size and then take everything out from the original tables and then rehash it again, okay? It's an expensive exercise. Right, so you say, how can we ensure that the quadratic probing always terminates? Make sure that your load factor is less than 0.5. Okay, otherwise you will have that problem. And the other one is two keys that have the same initial position. That means two keys two kids that have the same home address, they will have to follow the same code sequence. Okay, they have to follow the same path. 1 + 1 + 3 + 5 and so on, right? So you have to follow the same path. So therefore, they cluster along this path, right? And we call this the secondary clustering. So meaning that if you have 10 keys, all of them having the same home address, all these 10 keys will have to follow this path. And then the next one that come in with the same home address will have to go through all these N elements. And that is actually O(n). Okay? So it's not as bad as linear probing because it don't occupy home address for other keys, but still itself have this secondary clustering problem. Okay? So therefore, not many people will want to use quadratic probing. Neither linear probing, okay? Separate trending is okay, but you have to use linked list, yeah? So finally, people come up with this thing called the double hashing. So we know that the problem is because of the gap that we jump, okay? With different key, they jump the same gap. That is not good enough. So therefore, if we can find a method that actually allow us to jump different gaps, then you don't have this clustering problem, okay? Right, so what happened will be, if this hash key, the home address is not occupied, you put it there. If it is occupied, what you do is you put your key into the secondary hash function, right, and this secondary hash function will return a value. And you use this value to be the gap that you jump, right? You multiply this by 1, if it is occupied, you multiply this by 2. If this is occupied, you multiply this by 3. Of course, it's starting from the home address. But since they are of the same length or same depth, you do not need to come back to the home address in order to add 2 times that value, right? So you can start from where you stop and then add 1 more time. Okay, so that is what we call the double hashing. And the function is called the secondary hash function. Right, so let's see. We have the same table, size 7, and the primary function is k-mod 7, and the secondary function is k-mod 5. Right, so we have already inserted 14 and 18. Yeah? 14 mod 7 is 0, 18 mod 7 is 2 to 4. Now I try to insert 21. 21 mod 7 is 0. So this is a home address. So what we do, you put 21 into the secondary hash function, 21 mod 5 is equal to 1. Right? So therefore, you add 1 and you put it there. You see? So now I have to insert 4. 4 mod 7 is equal to 3. So I just, 4 mod 7 is equal to 4. So it is occupied, right? So what you do? You put your 4 into here, and it's actually 4 again. Right? So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. And it is occupied, so you go 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 go inside here. Okay, so you jump the same gap, same amount. Okay? Right, so now I want to insert 35. 35 mod 7 is 0. Yeah, so 35, this is the home address. So you put 35 inside here. And you find that 35 mod 5 is also 0. So what do? You jump 0. So you jump 0, you come back to here. It is still occupied, you jump 0, you come back to here. Jump 0, you come back to here. Right, so you can never go away because you are hentakaki there. Hentakaki. Chinese people call it li ting ta fu. That means you just stepping on the spot. Actually, I was trying to find the Google search for Google translation, and let's try and see what happened. You know, the good thing is when I key in this, they straight away know that this is Malay. And then in English is stamping fit. So stamping. But if you change it to Chinese, this is a funny translation. I don't know what is this. Any idea? Now talking about translation, there are many story before. Do you know when, who is the first president from USA to visit China? Who was the first president? Nixon, Nixon. So at the time when he visited China, Mao Zedong was the president of, or the chairman of China. Right, so the normal protocol is that the chairman will bring his wife to the airport, and then when the Nixon or when the president of USA come down, you know, Nixon do not speak Chinese and Mao Zedong do not speak did not speak English, so they have interpreter, right? Interpreter. So of course they talk nice thing about each other, right? So then this Nixon look at Jiang Qing and say, "Oh, you have a beautiful wife." Okay, and then Mao Zedong was, of course, translator says, "Oh, your太太很漂亮." So the, you know, to be diplomatic, you have to say, "Oh, you know." So Mao Zedong say, "Nali, nali." Okay, the translator say, "Which part, which part?" So those kind of translation, yeah. So I was trying to see which part down here, it was okay. So, you know, it's a naive part, which part? I mean, this kind of translation. So the idea is that the translation thing at the moment are still not perfect. Okay, so it's up to you all to also, if you're interested, you know, you can continue to study computer science. Later we will talk about it. And then you see whether you can come up with a more perfect translation, and then you go and work for Google to make sure that the translation is okay. Anyway, so I say all these things is not just to tell a joke or something like that, but it's actually to help you to remember things, okay? And as I said during help session, sometimes I say things during lectures, there are meaning inside there, okay? It's a reminder or helping you to remember something, okay? During exam, if you see a question and then you do not know what is it, maybe you want to think about some of the things that I say during lectures. Maybe you can answer the question because of that. Okay, it's up to you. Right, so the problem down here is because the secondary hash function return a zero. And if you have a zero, that means there's no gap to jump. Yeah, there's no gap to jump. So therefore, you cannot have a secondary hash function that returns zero. You must have some other things. Okay, so this is not acceptable. So normally, what we do is we use this pattern, okay, this kind of pattern. If the primary hash function is like, for example, 7 minus key mode 7. This is a table size M, right? M is equal to 7. What you do is the secondary hash function normally is this pattern, okay? This value is normally less than the table size, the original table size, yeah? And at the same time, this value and this value are core prime. We didn't say down here, okay? Core prime. Meaning that these two has no common factor. Okay, need not be prime number. Huh? This guy need not be prime number. You can say 4. It's okay, because these 4 and 7 are core prime, and that's fine, okay? And we know that if you do this, because of this 5 minus something, this one, the value is from 0 to 4, right? The remainder of something divided by 5 is 0 to 4. So 5 minus this is going to give you 1 to 5. Right, so it will never be zero, okay? There will be people who say, can I do this? Key mode 5 plus 1. This will definitely not equal to zero, right? Can we do this? Cannot. So this one plus 1 means what? If you are down here, and then you can do this using this to be the secondary function, you are going to find that you are trying to check this condition, check this location. So to be careful about this, if you want to plus one after you mode, you should mode one more time. Okay, because otherwise you return a one, and if you are down here, you might somehow go to the next one and without doing it. Okay, wait, I think if you just plus one. Okay, because you need to bring it to the front. Okay, you need to bring it to the front. Okay, otherwise if you add one and then you are down here, you might end up with the next value behind. So you have to be careful about this. Yeah. Okay, so we have studied all the four different methods, and eventually people use double hashing most of the time. I don't think anyone want to use linear probing or quadratic probing. Okay, so you have to use double hashing. So from the discussion, we know that for a good collision resolution method, it must satisfy all this, right? Minimize clustering. So linear probing is out. Quadratic probing is out. Always find the empty slot. So this one prevents us using quadratic probing because we don't want it to be restricted by this load factor. Okay, Java actually use 0.75. Okay, later you will see. And then we want to have different gap when two different key hash into the same home address. We want to jump different gap, and then it must be fast. Okay, so we don't want to spend a lot of time in order to find the slot. So if we satisfy all those conditions, we say that hashing on average can give us 0.1 for the three operations. Okay, and it's much faster than sorted array or non-sorted array, even faster than BST if you study 2010, okay, subsequently. Okay, so you have to, if you want to know binary search tree, you have to go and study 2010. Right, so we have gone through this, and we study how to hash, how to resolve collision, and all those things. Yeah? So this is just a checkpoint for you to check whether you understand everything down there. Java also provides us with some hash table. You can use them without creating your own function. Right, so in particular, we have this hash table that can take in a key and a value. Okay, and this hash table actually is a subclass of dictionary. Okay, dictionary have a key and then have a value also, right? And it implement the map interface, okay? And it also implement this guy. Right, so this class implement a hash table which map key to values, okay? Any non-null object can be used as a key or as a value, right? Either way, depending on what you want to use as key to find the slot and what you want to store inside the table. Okay, so it says we can create a hash table that map people names to their ages. Okay, or in this case, you use name as key and the ages as the values. So the dictionary class is an abstract parent of any class. So that means there are methods inside there that are not implemented. You are supposed to implement it if you want to extend it. Okay, so generally, as I say just now in Java, they use the load factor 0.75. So definitely we know that they are not using quadratic probing. Okay, they can allow up to 0.75. The default table size is equal to 11, n equal to 11. But if you feel that you need more, you can actually specify the default by doing something like this. Okay, so the initial table capacity, if you feel that you want to handle value of this class, we know that it's 141 now. So if you want to allow up to 0.75, you just multiply by what? 141 multiplied by this. See how many you have to put in the class size. So multiply by this to decide the class size, right, in the initial capacity. Okay, so you can use this, take the default given by Java without specifying the initial table size, without specifying the load factor. Or if you want, you can specify the initial capacity and the load factor if you want, okay? Right, so there's another new version called HashMap. I think a lot of you already use it during your CN lab, your take-home lab, and so on. So it's about the same. Right, so some of the methods inside there, you can clear the table, and then you can check whether this key is inside there, or this value is inside there, contain this key, contain this value, so you can all use all these methods. Get that particular, given the key, get the object, get the value, okay? Put this value with this key inside the table. Right, so all this, you should try to do it yourself, read it and then understand how to do it. This is just an example. So create a hash table that map people names to the edge. Yeah. So name is a key, H is actually the value. Yeah. So I create this generic class or generic object, and then using hash table, which is actually string and integer. Right. So when I put my with 52, meaning that my is actually the key, and 52 is actually the value. Right. So you will be put inside there. So I put three more people, and then I just print them out. So the code will actually print out this guy, okay? Because you are getting Janet, so you will print out 46. Okay, try it out yourself so that you know how to use them. And that is the end of hashing. Right, so I promised that we will discuss exception during the last lecture. Right, so we'll go through and talk about all these topics during this discussion. Look at one example first. If you write this, this program, very simple, you create a scanner object, read in two value, and then you just do this computation. You want to find out what is C by dividing A by B, right? So the user can enter any value, right? When you ask them to enter A and B, what happens if user enter 0 for B? B is 0, right? So if you don't do anything else, this is going to cause a overflow problem, because something divided by 0 is infinity, right? So the system will not be able to handle it, and you did not handle it yourself, so what happened will be the system crash your program, and it will just output this exception message to say that there is this arithmetic exception divided by 0, okay? And then it will tell you which statement actually give you the problems. Right, so this is a problem inside or runtime error inside the program, and in this case, all the object-oriented programming languages call this kind of thing exception. Okay, meaning that an error has occurred and there's an exception inside there. The program cannot run normally. Right, so you say that as the program does not indicate how to handle this division by zero, the system will take over the control and crash the program after printing out the messages. Right, so the other thing I want to mention is this. You know, some of you have exception during PE, and apparently I think they do not know how to overcome the exception. The idea is, as I say, this line number tell you where the exception occurs. You should try to see what that line was trying to do. Okay, most of the time I think you have two problem. One is index out of bound, array index out of bound. The other one is null pointer exception. Right, so you have to see, okay, given this line, you want to check before that whether the index, if it is index out of bounds, you want to see why this index is out of bounds. What is the value inside the index? Right? Then you see the statement before, whether you need to change something. And if it's null pointer, you want to check why is it that you have a null pointer. Maybe inside the while loop, the condition was not checked properly. Okay? Right, so the other thing is, if you do not know, what you do is you put in some print line statement, by asking the computer to print the value for you so that you can see why it is actually out of bounds or why it is equal to null, right? So do something like that. So what is an exception? You say that exception is an event that disrupts the normal flow of the program, the normal execution of the program. And this event is usually described by an object. So what it means is because this object oriented, right? When you want to throw an exception or this exception occurs, actually there's an object involved. Okay, so subsequently you're going to see that if you want to throw an exception, you actually have to mute an object. You have to create an object and use this object to throw. You know? So when you want to throw at people, you want to throw things at people, you have to get an object, right? Then you throw, right? Yeah. So you have to throw an object. You cannot just say, I throw what? Throw message. You have to throw an object, yeah? You have to create the object and then you throw that object. And exception handling is a process of detecting and responding to the exception. So we say that exception handling, there are two things. One, someone has to throw, and then two, someone has to catch to handle the exception. Okay, so if you are not the one who handle the exception, and if You can receive an exception from someone else. Someone throw the object to you. If you don't want to handle it, you have to throw again. Right, so you can throw and throw and throw, like hot potato. I throw and hot potato to you, it's too hot for you to handle, to throw. Someone else has to catch it. And if everybody refuses to catch it, then the system will take over. At the end of it, then the program will crash. Okay, something like that. So this process of catching and handling the exception is called exception handling, okay? An error is a specific type of exception that the program usually cannot handle, okay? Error and exception is different in the sense that you cannot do anything. When this happens, you have to crack, okay? For example, we say this many times, I want to create an array of large size, but the computer don't have enough memory for you to create this array. It will crack, okay? Because you cannot say, I handled it by what? Go and buy memories and then put it inside the computer and continue. You can't, right? Not at the time when you're executing the program already. So this kind of program, this kind of problem, you cannot handle. There's no way, okay? Like for example, file not found, or you know, when you try to open the file cannot be found inside the computer. You cannot handle it. Because it's not found, you have to, the program has to stop and then you try to go and find the file and put it into the directory. You know, that kind of things. Okay, so why is it that exception handling is important? It provides a means to separate those code that handle exception from the normal execution, normal function code, right? So that it is clear. Okay, if something unexpectedly has happened, I can do it down here. Okay, the other code are supposed to handle the normal execution. You don't want to mix them up. Yeah. And also, you can organize your code in such a way that you can handle different kind of problem at different places, so that you know. Okay, if this happens, meaning that this is a problem. If this happens, this is a problem. You can organize it in such a way that your program becomes very clear. Yeah. Right. So, for example, if I have a program that want to calculate the number of donuts and whatever for my breakfast, I can write something like this. Yeah. Getting the scanner to read in the number of donuts and read in the how many liter of or glasses of milk that I have. Right. So, if without the exception, you might have to use some if statement to check. Okay. If the number of for milk is less than 1, meaning that 0, then you have to say no more milk, go and buy. Right? Using the if statement, print out a statement, print out a message. Otherwise, you continue. Okay, so this is the normal. You count the number of donut, number of glass of milk, and then you print it up. With exception, you can actually change this part of the code into this. So you can put the calculation inside this try block. So this is where the normal execution of the statement are done, inside the try block, okay? And if something happened, meaning that if one of the statement actually caused problem, okay, it caused an error, and you want to handle it, you can use a catch block to do it, okay? So this is to catch this exception when you have this milk equal to 0, right? And this exception is called arithmetic exception. You are doing some calculation, right? So this is class under the arithmetic exception inside Java. And if this happens, you can come here and say, I want to print out this message, go and buy some more milk and that kind of thing, okay? So this exception handling is separated from the normal normal code. You do not need to put this statement inside there to handle it yourself. Now you can just simply throw an exception, or the system will throw an exception, then you catch it. Okay, so how do you throw? He said that when exception is detected by a program, it can be thrown, okay? Meaning that this exception can be thrown, you make it to become an object, and you throw with a throw statement, okay? Example. Right, and the other thing is that you can have this throw statement appear anywhere in your program, okay? As long as you throw, someone has to catch it. The code that deal with the exception is to catch the exception, to handle it, to deal with it. Syntax. Right, so you just throw without S. This is later you'll see the one that is with S. New exception class. So you can see, as we say, you are supposed to create a new object of this exception class. So this is either user-defined class or one class inside the Java. Okay, you can use the Java exception class. And normally you provide a message, okay, so that the exception object can actually pass this object this message back to the calling method, and then this message can be displayed over there. Okay, if you don't want to put any message inside there, what you need to do is just put the empty parameters. Okay? Right, so the, in a program, if you want to include exception handling, this will be the layout. First of all, you have the try blocks. Right, the normal execution of all the statements that you want to have, but you put in those statements that you think can cause problems, or method that you can call, which can actually throw exception to you. You put them all inside that, right? So this one, either statement or one statement, it could be 100 of statements inside there, 100 of method call and so on, right? So if you expect anything that can have problem, you can put it into a try block, right? And then you have various catch statement, catch block, right? So the, if you expect that there are two kind of problems that can be thrown by all these statements inside there, you provide the catch block to handle all these possible exceptions that will be thrown at you, right? So the exception class one, like for example, the aromatic exception, and then what kind of identifier, right? The second one and so on. You look at example. And then there is a finally clause, okay? So this is for clean-up purpose, meaning that whether there's any exception down here or not, you will still come here to do something. If there's exception, you will do one of them and you will come down here to do something also. Whatever cases, whether you have exception or you don't have exception, the finally clause will be executed. Of course, you can ignore this. You don't want to put anything inside there because you do not need to do anything. You just want to return. You can ignore this part, okay? And there are three types of exception. Yeah, there are three types. One is called the ordinary exception. We say that these are exceptions that occurs at predictable location, right? So for example, you are trying to open a file inside your program, and you know that there is a possibility that the file cannot be found inside the directory, then therefore at this point, you have to put in a statement or try it to see whether the file can be found. If you don't do it, actually you get a syntax error. Later I show you something. Second type is called runtime exception. This one you cannot predict because you do not know whether the user is going to enter something that is, like for example, the IO exception. You are expecting the user to enter an integer value, but the user enter character. You cannot expect that you do not know, right, that the user is going to enter character value, right? So if that's the case, we say that this is actually a runtime exception. And then finally, as we say, there's the error where we cannot handle memory out of running out of memory, stack memory, or that kind of things. Okay, so we say that an exception can be thrown, and then these are actually created as classes, as we said just now. And in order to do that, we have to create those classes under the superclass called exception. Okay, and in fact, there's a runtime exception down here, which is actually a subclass of this, and then the user-defined classes are all the other side. Okay, then we will see. Right, so you say that the program must have code to handle this exception, right? So any exception that is under this side will be considered as a check exception. Okay, and you must handle it yourself. Right, so ordinary exception, like for example, far not far exception, IO exception, and then the user created defined exception, they are all over here, not the runtime, yeah, over here. Those are actually called the check exception, and you must handle it yourself. And then you have the class of runtime exception over this side. If it is runtime exception, your program need not declare and need not handle it. Okay, when we say need not declare and need not handle, is when during compilation time. Okay, if it is a check exception, if you don't do it in your code, you get compilation error. Okay, runtime error, however, you do not need to do it. If you don't do it, you don't say anything, there's no compilation error. You will only encounter the problem when you run it and it occurs. Then you get this crash of your program and so on. Yeah. So all these are what we call the runtime error. Error, array index out of bounds, null pointer exception, and all those things. They are all over this side, the runtime errors. Right, so this runtime error is also called unchecked exception. Okay, the name. Yeah. And we say that this is actually a subclass of exception, right? So what I want you to do is, you know, When I say this, you might not get what it means. So sometimes it's good to look at explanation given by people. So I have found this slide. Found this website. If you go there, they give a very good explanation. So you go there, and then what you do is you just say check versus uncheck. So they give a very good explanation down here, and then they also give an example. Okay, for example, this guy, this is actually a main program. And inside here, you try to open a file. Okay, and this program did not indicate that how to handle the problem with when the file is not found. Right? So when you compile this program, you actually get error. Down here, yeah, this is actually the error message telling you that this is a check exception and you did not handle it. So what you need to do is just simply put in these words down here. Throw IO exception, because this file and then buffer reader will be actually considered under IO exception. So once you put this inside there, without changing any other things, okay, just in the header, you put this thing inside there and you can compile. Okay, so as I said just now, unchecked exception is actually over here. These are all unchecked, yeah? And then over here, the runtime is also unchecked. But anything that's under the exception over here, you declare yourself or you use those exceptions under the created by Java, they are all considered to be checked exception. Okay? So anything that you have down here, you must put something in the program heading to say that this method can throw this exception. Okay, if you don't put, you get compilation error. So check and uncheck is just a compile time kind of things. Okay? So try to read this and try to understand it. Yes. Right, so class error, as we say already, is something that you cannot handle because you do not know that your program is going to use up all the memory space. You have a recursive call, you use up all the stack memory. You cannot handle it, that kind of problem, right? The system will crash and then you have to restart that and so on. Right, and the idea is you can also handle more than one exception inside your program by doing something like this, right? So you try. So these are all the possible method call to some other method. Yeah? And each one of them can throw an exception. Right, so like for example, this guy can throw maybe divide by zero, and this guy can throw another exception. Okay? So you just put them into catch block. And to be safe, you can actually say, I want to catch all the possible exceptions. So this is the top of the exception class, right? If you put it this way, that means all the exceptions that can happen down here, if you don't have this, you will be caught by this. This is the most general exception that can happen, right? And therefore, previously, I don't know, maybe Java 5 and so on, you can do like this. You can even put this guy in front. If you put the catch exception in front, what happens? Because it's actually checking the exception one after the other. If you put this guy in front, it will catch all the exception, right? Whether it's aromatic exception, whether it's null pointer exception, whether it's input, what they call index out of all exception, will be caught by this guy if you put it on top, right? Then you will not know whether it is null pointer or whether this is index out of bound. Correct or not? Okay? Previously, they allow you to put that. But now, if you try to put it there, you get a syntax error. Yeah, because once you put this one there, the compiler will detect that this is going to catch all the exceptions. And if that's the case, what is the point of putting this and what is the point of putting this? They will tell you that this is not allowed. Okay, compilation error. So now you must always put this one last if you want to put it inside there. Okay? Right, so there's a class called throwable, right? So this is actually the mother of all exception class. That means throwable is on top before, below, above the exception class, yeah? Right, so you say the common superclass of exception and error. So you have error down here, exception down here. So this is a throwable. Okay, so this is the most general exception to be specified. You can use a throwable things, yeah? Then the finally clause, as I say just now, it will actually do execute this clause whether you have an exception or you don't have an exception. Okay, you will always be go there. Right. So even if there's no exception down here, this one have an exception, right? Because you're going to debug by zero. So even if you have this, it will not stop. It will do this part, and then it will somehow come down to do this. Okay, so I created these programs to show you how you work. So it's just copying what we see over here. So maybe first of all, I show you if I do this, the compiler is going to complain. So you say this exception has already been caught by the general exception class, right? So you cannot do that. Right, so if we compile this now, so you will actually print out all these things, which is actually this statement, okay? And then you will, this is when I take away the, wait, let me see, where this? There's a divide by zero down here, which is the exception inside here, inside this message, divide by zero, because this is, when this is equal to zero, you have this divide by zero problem here, right? And it's caught by this catch block down here. And this guy actually print divide by zero here, okay? And then it will come down here to the finally clause to actually print out this statement, which is actually, if you look at this, it's actually this statement down here, okay? So even if you have a exception, it will come down to do that, okay? What happens if there's no exception? Right, what I need to do is to change, take away this, right? Regular screen. Right, so you actually print out this, and then where is the statement that say, how do I clear screen? Hmm. Huh? Clear? Okay, let's see. So there's an exception. Because I was entering something. Try exception. So it actually, I was supposed to enter something. Yeah. You will see this message again. Still come down to do it. Okay, so the idea is the finite clause is there to do whatever you need to do. Like for example, if you want to release some of the memory space back, or you know, you need to do some cleaning up, you have to use the finite clause to do it. Okay? Yeah, so this divide by zero will throw this exception, which is actually a Java declare or define exception. Right, so if you want to handle the exception inside a method, or if this method is going to throw an exception, you must declare this inside the heading. Okay, you must do this. So just like I told you, right, this is throw, but this is throws with the S. Okay, in the heading, you have to say throws with the S. Inside the method, you throw the exception without the S, yeah? Okay, so exception have been thrown in it. If you have this, you must put this inside your program heading. Otherwise, you are going to get syntax error, okay? Or the exception might be thrown by a method that you call. So for example, I call these two methods, and you know that these two methods can throw exception. You must also put that into the heading. Otherwise, you get syntax error, compilation error. Okay, so how do you define your own exception? So you declare new class, and call this the name that you want. Okay, so this is divide by zero exception, your own exception class. And we say that it's extend the exception. So exception is a super class. And you declare this as a normal class. So therefore, you should have the constructor. Right, so this constructor actually call the super class constructor to create the super class object and send in this as the message, okay, to the super class exception class, right? And then, you can have also using the whatever message that you want to throw. During the throw, you put in this message. The same thing, this message can be sent to the super class constructor so that when an exception occurs, this message will be used to display. Yeah? Right, so how do you do it? How do you use it? So very simple, I just enter the same thing and then I get, I try this to see whether I can divide A by B, and this is a method. Right, so when B is equal to zero, I throw this new exception that I have just created, the class that I have just created. So I create an object of this class and send in this message to be the message to be displayed when exception occurs. Okay, so that's how you do it. And then otherwise, if this is not zero, I return A divided by B. Okay, so in this case, because I have done this, I catch this exception, and actually handle this exception already. So therefore, it will actually come down to do this statement. Understand? Meaning that the exception, even though there's an exception down here, A divided by zero, okay? So this exception has been caught by this catch block, so therefore it's deal with it already. It will not crash the system, right? So therefore, it will come down to do this, which print out C is equal to 100. And that's why you have C equal to 100 down here. Understand this? Okay? If I do not have this, I take away this, and take away this, and I take away this, the normal execution of this will cause this to be crashed, okay, cause the program to be crashed because you never handle it. And if that's the case, you will never print out this statement. Okay? So that's how exception is handled. Okay, I think we take a break and then we come back to finish up the modules. 5 minutes. Okay, so this Thursday, the lab is optional. If you have already submitted your hash program, you do not need to go. But if you feel that you want to ask the TA question, you can still go there. Okay, the TA are supposed to be there. Right, you can go there and ask them questions. So we are not going to mark attendance for this Thursday. Okay? Friday tutorial is compulsory. Friday, you still need to go for the tutorial, the final tutorial. Okay, so this week, this afternoon, 3 to 5, tomorrow, Thursday, 2 to 4, we are going to continue to have a help session, right? But next week, because it's a reading week already, right, so the help session will be the same time, same place, but I'll organize it a little bit differently. So this week, every help session, you have the same thing, so you just go to one of them. But next week, I'm going to do it in such a way that 2 days will have different topics or different things that we discuss, but the other 2 days will just repeat, yeah? So something like this. Right, so Monday, Wednesday, like for example, Monday, maybe we discuss the last semester paper. And then Wednesday will be 2 semesters ago, something like that. So different papers, yeah, Monday and Wednesday. And then we will repeat them on Tuesday and Thursday. So that people can come. But if you really cannot come Monday and Wednesday, what do you do? You come Monday and Thursday. That will be fine. Or you can come Tuesday and Wednesday. So you will get the same set of things that we discussed. Yeah? So it's up to you to do your things. So Monday is 2 to 4, 2 to 4. Tuesday is 3 to 5. This is 2 to 4. Right, so look at the announcement inside IDLE. Okay, so we are going to conclude our modules by doing this thing called mix and match. You have learned many, many different kind of data structures. You have learned many different kind of algorithms. Yeah? So how do you apply them when you are solving problem? Okay, so the idea is you cannot say all the methods, all the problems that we give you, you can only use stack to do it, or you can use only Q to do it. Sometimes you have to combine them, okay? Either to improve the efficiency or simply just to solve the problem. You have to combine different data structures, okay? You have to learn how to do it. And for different applications, you have to ask yourself which is the best data structures or which is the best algorithm to do it, okay? So how do you decide? So we are saying that we can actually have data structures with multiple organizations, different kind of data structures combined together. Right, so we say that these are the three basic building block in the data structures, the basic. So you know you learn array already, you learn linked list, and subsequently you learn tree. So these are the three data structures that you can use to actually solve a lot of problems, okay? Or you combine them. Right, you can combine them to implement different data structures or different different application. So for example, you have already learned this, okay? Array of linked list, something like this. Just now you said, this is one way to solve collision, right? Separate chaining. Okay, so you have an array. This is a head table. And then all the key that have the same home address will be put inside the linked list. So this one you have already used. You also learn something, I don't know, not during this lecture, but some of you went to the help session. We say that you can do what we call bucket sort. Okay, you can do sorting if you know the range of value, right, that you want to do, you want to sort, like for example, the midterm test result. So you can create an array of 0 to 100, and then those students that have the same value, you put into the linked list, right? So you can actually combine linked list with array to do sorting, okay, bucket sort, and so on. So there are many, many other applications that can make use of this. So sometimes people call this segmented linked list. Okay, each one is one segment, and then you have the linked list out there. Okay, so sometimes we also can use this to represent a graph. Okay, sometimes we call this the adjacency list, okay, to represent a graph. We'll look at example. Or hash table, okay, for separate trending, we say already. So as I said, so this is actually an adjacency list to represent a graph like this. So a graph is actually edges connecting vertices. All right, for example, the travel salesman problem. You connect all the supermarket, and then this salesman is supposed to go to all the supermarket in order to achieve the best or optimal result and that kind of thing, right? So if there's a link from one vertex to the other, right, so this is vertex one, you go to two, so you will have a link to point to two, the node two, right? And two can go to four, so two can go to four. Three can go to two, so three can go to two. Three can also go to four, and then four cannot go anywhere, so this is a dead end. Five can go to three and go to four, so five can go to three, can go to four. Now, so you can represent a graph like this using array of linked list. Okay, so this is what we call the adjacency list. You can also use a two-dimensional matrix to represent a graph. Okay, we can do that. Right, so again, if one go to two, so one can go to two. You put a one down there. Okay, three can go to two, three can go to two. Okay, three can go to four, three can go to four. Right, so you just put the one in the corresponding shell inside that row and column to indicate that from here you can go there. Okay, so this is what we call adjacency matrix to represent a graph. Okay, so you can use array to represent a graph like this. Right, so let's say I want you to create this application. Okay, so this is actually a exam question. We didn't say, yeah, 1, 10, 20. 2003 don't have 1020. It's a CS1102 paper, yeah? So they have actually many other data structures inside that. So if I give you this problem, how do you solve this problem? Okay, a lot of marks, 18 marks, 16 marks. So it said that let Ni be the number of vertices adjacency to vertex I. So that means if this is I, Ni will be, like for example, if say Ni is equal to 4, meaning that this guy has four neighbors. He connects to four other vertices, yeah? And suppose we want to support the following four operations, meaning that I want you to create an ADT, a new class that will be able to support these four operations, okay? And they are supposed to be supported in, or doing done in O1 time for these three operations, and it's supposed to be done in ONI time for this operation. If I want to find the neighbors, if the Ni is equal to 4, you should only look at this 4. You shouldn't be looking at the rest. And to insert, to delete, to check whether it's inside there, you have to do it in O1 time. Okay? So of course, when you say O1 time, oh, maybe we do hashing. But how do you indicate the link and all those kind of things? Okay, so because this is actually a directed graph means there's an arrow from 1 to 2. If you have only like that, then you cannot go from 2 to 1, okay? Can only go from 1 to 2. Okay, so how do you do this? How do you do this? So we say, let's use a two-dimensional array, a matrix to do this, okay? Something like that. So the graph that we've seen over there is actually represented using this two-dimensional array. So how do you insert a new connection? Meaning that now I want to insert, like for example, 3 before, previously cannot go to 4. Right now, MLT say, okay, we can go there. So I want to set this, so what do you do? What must you do to do insert? Just change this to T, right? And this is done. So this is O1, right? Insertion into a adjacency matrix is O1, very fast. Deletion, I want to delete this guy. That means this connection is no longer there. Someone bombed it, and yeah. So you just take away this, is O1, right? To check whether there's a connection from one place to the other, you just go through that to check. Okay, this one say true, you return true. So this is O1. But to check all the neighbor of this guy, I want to find out how many neighbor I have, what must you do? You will never know that there's one that is only, there's only one that is true, right? You have to go through this whole row to find all the possible neighbor. If that's the case, this is O(n). Right, so you can see that these three operations satisfy the requirement. The question asks you to come up with algorithm that provide you with O1 for these three operations, okay? But for the neighbor, they want you to find ONI, not ON. Right, so this is no good, this is too slow. So we know that simply using two-dimensional array cannot solve this problem because of the checking the neighbors. So we try to see whether we can use adjacency list, yeah? So to insert, I know that I want to insert, like for example, 1 to previously you have a 2 down here, right? 1 to 3. So what do? I can just simply insert a new note down here, and that is 01. Okay, from 1 to 3, I just insert a new note, and that is 01. To delete is O and Y. Y deletion is O N. Given, like for example, 2, I want to find this guy, I had to go through the list. Right? So if this node is actually connected to all the neighbor, then this operation is O N, because to find it first, and then I delete, right? So I have to search for it first and then delete. So it's O N. Similarly, checking whether the connection is there, you have to search through the whole list, which is O N. And finally, the neighbor is O N I. Yeah, because this guy has all these neighbors. So if there are 2 of them, I just need to go and look at the 2. If there's only 1, I just need to look at 1. I do not need to look at the rest. Okay? So therefore, this is good, but this is no good, and this is no good. So the idea is, you ask yourself, can I do something else to help me to improve the efficiency of these 2 so that I can use this to do it? We know that this method, you can never help to improve this. You need to go through the whole row. Right, so you can include other data structures in order for you to actually see what are the neighbor that this guy has. Right? You cannot. So we want to see whether after keeping this and this, can we improve this to O1, okay, from ON to O1. Right, so how do you do it? Right, searching and on an unsorted linked list is ON. How do we improve it to O1? Okay, so therefore, as you say, during the analysis time, when you are looking at this problem, you ask yourself, which data structures that we learn in this module can allow you to do searching with O1 time? Then the first thing that comes to your mind must be hashing. Yeah, hashing. Hashing can allow you to do searching in O1 time, right? The rest, can you do it in O1 time? Sorted linked list, sorted arrays, unsorted array, all of them has to be O(n), right? So the only one that can use is actually hashing. So you think about how to use hashing to do this. Right, so this is actually the solution. So the idea is given a linked list, right, so this guy is linked to here. So I want to know whether that particular connection is there. I want to search for those things inside that. So I know that if I want to search for I and J, I need to be able to go to this node straight away. Given J, and of course I is down here, right? So what do you need to do? I need to create a hash table, right? And then put I and J to be the key, and then the value that I want to put inside this hash table is actually a pointer pointing to this node. Can you understand this? Yes? I and J to be the key, and then the value that I store in this hash table is actually the address of this node. The reference of this node. When you create this node, when you insert it into the linked list, you know the address, right? So with this I and J as the key, you put it, you create a node and put it into the hash table. Okay? So when you are doing searching, very simple. I want to search whether 3 and 2 is inside there. I put 3 to be my I and 2 to be my J. Go through the hash function. If it return true, I will get the address and I will be able to say that, yeah, this node is inside that. There's a connection between these 2. Okay? So searching that can become O1 already. Searching become O1. Once you have this, what about deletion? Right? So we say that searching become O1 now by using a hash table. Using the I and J to be the key, and then the reference to the node to become address. I mean the value. What about deletion? I found that I want to delete this node by using the method to do searching. Is this deletion O1? This only give me the address of this node. I want to delete this. What must I do? Okay, if you delete from a linked list, a single linked list, I want to delete this. I know this reference given by the hash function. I know this reference. To delete this, I need to link this to here, right? I still need to go and find this pointer, right? And to find this pointer, I have no choice but to start from the front and then traverse until this one next equal to this. Then I stop. And then I set this to here. So the worst case is still ON. Yes? The worst case is still ON, right? You have to start from the front, traverse until you reach the nodes before, and then you delete it. It's still ON. So how do I improve this to O1? Huh? Any suggestion? You need to know the pointer before. Double linked list. Yeah. So you make this to become double linked list. And so therefore, when you know this, you will be able to just go before and then find the notes, the address of this, and then you just set this pointer over there. Yeah. So you change this to, you improve this to O1. Yeah, so that's the idea. I actually combine array of linked list plus a hash table, array of double linked list plus a hash table. So the answer to that question is just like that, 16 marks. So you say use hashing, ij as the key, and the hash value returned by the function to be the index to the hash table, where ij is stored together with the reference to the nodes in the linked list. Yeah, and then of course you have to say doubly linked list. Down here you have to say doubly linked list. Alright, so this is the explanation I gave. You can, yeah. So this is actually the answer. Doubly linked list, yeah. Doubly linked list. Okay, so you can see how you combine different data structures in order to solve the problem. Okay. Then we want to also look at the other sorting algorithm that see whether we can improve. As I said, for example, bubble sort, you use a Boolean fact inside there to say that if I go through one pass, there's no swap, that means it's already sorted. I don't want to continue with the rest of the passes, right? How to improve? So people think about merge sort. Can we improve merge sort by actually using a k-way merge sort? So the original merge sort is actually two-way. That means you divide them into two parts, and then eventually you merge two into one. Okay, so that's what the original one is called, two-way merge sort. So what is k-way merge sort? Like for example, in this case, k is equal to 4. So the idea is, if I divide them into four parts, the height of the tree will be shorter, right? If you divide it into two parts, the height is actually log 2n, correct? Or not? Yeah, the height of the tree or the recursive tree is log 2n. If I divide it into four, that means the height will be shorter. If the height is shorter, can I actually get a better performance or better complexity using k-way merge sort? Okay, so the idea is you break into four, and then after that you break again, and eventually you have this sorted already. You merge these four into one sorted hole. So the question is whether by doing this, you actually improve the efficiency of the merge sort. Right, so how do you do it? Let's say I have already merged, sorted all this, and then I want to merge them into one. So there are k of them inside here. So what do you do? You still need to look at all the n elements. So this is a temporary array where you store the sorted before you copy back to the original array, right? So in order to get one element to be put into the temporary array, I need to compare all these k elements, correct or not? To find the smallest. I have to find the smallest among all these and then put it there. So in this case, let's say 3. I put 3 down here. Okay? Then after that, I have to look at this 4 element, let's say, and then I put my 5 inside here. So for each element that I want to put into a temporary array, there are n of them. I have to look at k elements in order to find the smallest one and then put it there. And then after that, go back and look at the next 4, next k, and then put another one, right? So if that's the case, what is the complexity? So you are going to get something like this. So there will be all this recursive call. We say that the height is actually n, log kn, because you divide by k time, right? You divide by k. So therefore, the number of times you have to divide is actually log kn time. Okay, so the height is like that. And then as I say, then after that you combine them. Let's say you combine ki element into one and so on. Yeah. So what is the complexity? This one is the height. For each level, I need to look at all the n elements. And for each one of them, for each of the n elements, I need to look at k elements. Remember just now I said in this slide? Right, to put one element inside there, I have to look at k elements. So therefore, for the all the n elements that I want to put inside there, I have to look at kn elements. Yeah. So therefore, this is the complexity for doing k-way merge sort. Is this better than n log n? No, because it's actually multiplied by another thing. So this is actually, you can, as you say in big O notation, you can make it to become log 2n, right? So therefore, the this one actually is not better than the original one, because searching for one element to be put into the temporary array actually caused a K down there. So this is not very good. And we see that the bottleneck for this complexity, I mean this algorithm, is because of this process where I need to select the smallest one and put it inside here. So how do you improve this to make it faster? So people actually introduce something called a minimum heap. Of course, you haven't learned this, but it's okay. I'll just describe to you. Right, so the minimum heap is actually like a triangle, right? It's actually, we go this way. Right? So the minimum heap, sorry. You better put it this way. The minimum is always on top. Right? You create this minimum heap, and then the minimum is always on top. Right, so you can remove this and put it into the array. And then the heap operation will pop the smallest one to the top. You will move the smallest one to the top again. Okay? And the process of doing insertion and deletion, meaning that every time I remove something, I have to go and get the next value to be put inside there. Remember this? I first of all make this to become 3, 5, 6, and 10. So this is a heap with the K element, with these four elements. So I remove this and put it inside here. Right? The process, when you do remover, you are going to put the 5 on top, and then the heap become like that. Then I will insert this 9 inside that. Okay? Then it will become 5, insert 9 is here, so 9 go up, 9, 10, and then 6. Okay, so the process will actually move the 5 to the top, and then you delete again. And we say that in this case, insertion deletion is all log n. That means instead of OK to find the value and then to put inside there, it's actually now become log k. Log k, because you have k element inside here. Okay, so this becomes log k. Right, log k down here, rather than the OK. So of course, OK is much faster, longer than log k, right? Right, so if that's the case, what is the complexity? Now, this is still the same, the height is still the same. Okay? In order to find one element to be put into the array, is log k now, log 2k, because it's binary. Yeah? And we need to do k of them. So the total complexity will be this, for the k-way merge sort. This will be the total complexity. So the question is whether this is better than this. Whether this is better than this. So look, if you look at this, this is equal to what? If I change this to base 2, so I will have n log 2k, and then this log 2n over log 2k, right? I change this to this. Changing base. Everybody understand this, right? Know how to do this, right? Okay, so once you have done this, sorry, this is 2k. You see that there's a 2 log 2k down here, there's a log 2k down here. And what happened? You can cancel that off, right? So by doing this, you actually end up with n log 2n also. Exactly the same as the original complexity. So if that's the case, k way merge sort and 2 way merge sort, the complexity is exactly the same. No difference. Okay, because by doing this, changing the base, you are going to get this. So it's not really an improvement. But why we are mentioning this? The idea is even though it didn't really improve in terms of complexity, but in real life, it actually is slightly more efficient, and also there's real application. Right, for example, I don't know how many of you have credit card? Credit card. Or at least your parents have, right? So when they go overseas to go for holiday, let's say they go Europe, and then they travel 7 countries in Europe, and they spend money using the credit card. When they come home, they receive only one statement. Right, so the credit card company need to get all this information from different countries. And of course, they are not just getting your parents' credit card statement, right? It's all the customer. So what do they need to do? They have to merge them together in order to produce one statement. Yeah. So the idea is you might have Italy, Spain, England, or whatever. So the idea is you can do something like this, and then you get these two, and then you do something like this to get one, right? So you can see that all these things down here will be done 2 times. you are supposed to look at this and then look at this. Okay? But if you use K four-way merge sort, this four is going to go into one straight away. And you are going to access all this value only one time. By doing this, you access the value two times, correct or not? Because you have to merge these two into one, merge these two into one, and then you have to merge these two into one again. So you are accessing the statement, I mean the transaction two times. But if you do them in four K-way merge sort four-way, you only access the value one time only. It could be faster. Yeah, so in real life, sometimes the application can actually give you faster result in terms of runtime, not in terms of complexity. Complexity are exactly the same. Okay, so you have to think about what you want to do to make your customer happy by designing different kind of algorithm. Okay. So I suppose this is what you are most interested to know. Final exam, okay? We will cover everything for the whole semester, yeah? But the emphasis will be on the second half. So meaning that 30% will come from the first half. So OOP, Java, ADT, what else? Array, linked list, yeah, will come up. And then second half of the semester will cover 70%. Okay, 70%. So linked list, stack and queue, recursion, complexity analysis, sorting, and then hashing. Okay, those will be 70%. So you have to go and revise on your lecture notes, tutorial and labs, soap opera. Okay, so you have the experience of a midterm test already. So it's up to you. The format, okay, the exam date is Thursday 24th in the evening. So please, we have people who miss the PE because they mix up the date. And then during the makeup PE, he came and said that, can I do the makeup PE? I say, what is your supporting document? He said, I don't have. And I mix up the original date. That is not a valid excuse. So he was not granted permission to take the makeup PE, meaning that 50% is gone. Okay? So please, for exam, if you are mixed, if you don't go, you get zero for the 40%. Okay? I will remind you all by sending maybe an announcement, but it's up to you to remember. Venue not announced it. Most likely in one of the what they call multi-purpose sport hall, right? Duration 2 hours, so half an hour more than your midterm test. Post book, no help paper, no help sheet, totally closed. Section 1, 10 MCQ. Okay, reduce from 12, okay, to 10. So that you have more question, more time to do question, yeah? So 3 marks, each one. And then so total is 30 marks. You do the OCR form again. Section 2, 6 question. Okay, 6 question. Short answer question, short. Some of them has 2 parts, 3 parts, 4 parts, or even 5 parts. Very short. And then you answer in the paper. Total is 100 marks. So this is the 6th question. So you can go and guess which question is for which topics. You know, one topic, one question. So what is the color scheme? The green one, you are either giving answer or writing algorithm. Okay, no programming, no coding. The red one and the pink one means you have to write code, Java code. Okay, and you can see that this question is 10 marks, one question by itself. Okay, you're going to look at past paper, what is the kind of question? Okay? This one is in blue, algorithm. Okay, you're supposed to write algorithm, but it's actually 8 marks. I give you a hint. Look at the whole question first. Maybe the other three parts give you a hint of what you are supposed to do. Okay, maybe, I don't know. You have to go and see, yeah? Read these three parts and see what they are asking you to do, and then maybe that gives you some hints on how to solve this problem. Okay, so that is the format. Any question about this? No? Anyone have any question? Okay, no. Right, so normally we say this, please bring a good answer for you to do the OCR form. Write clearly with reasonable big characters. Okay, the space that we provide should be enough for you to write the answer, yeah? And so on. Please, write the matriculation number or your student number right at the beginning. If I'm inside the hall all by ourselves, I will give you the 5 minutes before the time for you to write and then to shape the OCR form, right? So please do that. As we said many times, at the end of the exam, we are not giving you extra time to do anything. Stop writing means stop writing. Okay, so that's what we practice, yeah? So we want to look at what we have done for this semester. Have we fulfilled the objective that we set up right at the beginning of the semester? Right, so we are saying that you should give and we are giving you an introduction to data structures and algorithm for constructing efficient algorithm. Right, so we introduce all the data structures and algorithm, and then we emphasize on efficiency at the end, right? And we emphasize on data abstraction, meaning that specification and all those things, we do not want you to look at the detail first. That's why the practice exercise will always tell you that you have to analyze and then come up with the algorithm before you start programming. So that is what we are asking you to do. And then efficiency, complexity analysis. So we have done all this, array, list, stack, queue, hash, table, together with the algorithm. And then we talk about sorting, different kind of paradigms, divide and conquer, greedy, sorting, search, and so on. And then we emphasize on analysis of complexity. So we only look at big O notation, not the other. So the question is, you ask yourself, the first day you come to these modules, and now, are you more proficient in writing programs? Be honest, you ask yourself. Have you improved? If not, then you really have to ask yourself, why not? Okay, maybe you didn't practice enough. You didn't listen to advice and kind of thing. So you really have to ask yourself, okay? So hopefully we have given you the skill that you need for future modules and also even future employment that you are going to do, okay, as a computer science graduate, okay? So after these modules, what are you supposed to do? So what is next? If you are not CS student, of course CS student have no choice, you have to go and do the rest, yeah? But if you are not CS student, continue to program. Okay, this skill is going to be with you for the rest of your life. If you stop now, you are going to forget. Like for example, you learn the language, Japanese or whatever. If you don't practice it, you forget. You give it back to me. I don't want you to give it back to me. Keep it with you. Okay, continue to do program, and maybe if you want to go and take some more other modules to 2010, because 1020 didn't give you the complete requirement for basic data structures. So it's good to go and continue with 2010. Okay, the idea is, you know, during my time, I was the third batch of computer science student in Singapore. Third batch. In Singapore introduces computer science degree in 1975. Okay, so I joined the university in 1977, so I was third batch. And because at that point, the facilities are very limited. Okay, we just have a mini computer. We don't have PC like this, okay? Every time we want to program, I don't know whether I told you before, we have to punch card, you know? One statement, one card. So if I write a 200-statement program, I have to punch 200 cards. And then I have to submit this card to the operator, right? And then they will run it only at night, batch processing, right? Then next morning, I go and get my printout to see whether my solution solved the problem, okay? If I make one syntax error, I have to change that card, submit again. and then wait again for the next morning to receive the printout. So, you know, one program can take you 1 week. Okay, you also take 1 week, but you know. But for us, it's not because we don't know how to solve it, but because of maybe, some logic error, some syntax error, and so on. So it's because of the turnaround time. We have to wait. Okay? So therefore, the course cannot take in so many students. And during my time, about 900 students applied to go into the course. But the department only take 42 students. Yeah, so we have to go through something called aptitude test. You know, those IQ tests and so on. So they selected 42, right? And so what happened to the rest of the students? They just take some modules, right? At the time we learned Fortran and COBOL and all those. So they come and take those modules. And then they learn themselves. And when they graduate, whether they are from mathematics or whether they are from physics, they become programmer. They become programmer because the industry requires them. So at the moment, it's the same thing. We cannot produce enough CS graduates to fulfill the requirement in the industry. They still need more, right? So it's good for you to continue to do this, and then maybe you can become a programmer, even though you might not be CS major. We have some science student down here, we have some mechanical engineering student down here, but you can become a programmer. Right, so continue to take some of these modules which are important. As I said, 2010, complete the data structures part, right? 2103, software engineering. You want to become a software engineer, you have to take 2103, okay? These two are mobile applications. So you want to learn how to write mobile application. Instead of catching monster, you go and create monster for people to catch. Yeah, games. And then this one, I highly encourage you because I wear this t-shirt every day, right? Oh, yeah, every day. We have one second in Jakarta. We are going to Yangon, we are going to Bangkok, we are going to Manila. Right, hopefully, one team becomes champion. So if you are good in programming, you can continue to practice, and then if you want, people like sitting in front of here, you can come and take part in this. Then maybe you can represent NUS to go for the region. And if you qualify, you go for world final. Once you are world finalist, you do not need to worry about career, because Google will come and look for you, Facebook will come and look for you. We have a lot of ICPC students now working in Google, working in Facebook in US. Because they know that you are a good programmer once you enter the good world final. Okay? Even before you go for world final, once you are inside the team that we sent for regional contest, the local company will look for you also. Garena. You all know what is Garena? Yeah, it's a game company and they have a website. So every year they will give us money to send students to the regional. This year they give us $15,000. That's why you can go there without spending any money. They sponsor us. And then they will invite this student to go for interview, give them internship, and their internship is paying higher than normal company, okay? And then if you are good, they will ask you to go in, right? The starting pay is $8,000 if you are selected. Right, so it's up to you. Right, so you can also take these modules in game development. Right, the other thing I want to mention is that these modules, they actually ask them to create apps, and then they ask them to put into, like, for example, Google Store, Apple Store, and so on. Then people download, right? So there was one student, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago, he created this app and put it up there. And for 2 weeks, his app was the top download apps. And the amount that he get enough for him to cover 4 years of tuition fee. In 2 weeks, he. So he just sit down there, 99 cents. Yeah, if you have something, you have some idea, good idea, and you think that everybody will need that kind of things, you create the app, and then after that, 99 cents will just come falling down on you. But of course, the important thing is not just the money, okay, but sometimes you have the satisfaction. Wow, you know, my things is recognized by a lot of people. Okay, so please continue. Don't stop here. This is not the end of the whole computing study, yeah? Right, so for people who are interested, I'm going to conduct this workshop, 3 days workshop, okay? And I haven't booked the place, but I will make an announcement. So 19th up to 21st of December. If you are free and if you are going for 2010, you can come for this. So I will just cover some of the important things, give you some exercise for you to do, free of charge. You do not need to pay anything, yeah? I will announce this. So I'm going to open up a forum page on IVLE, then you register. Put your name and maybe your email address. Okay, so the idea is once this module is completed, they close down IVLE. I cannot make announcement anymore. So I need to know who are coming so that I can book the venue and so on. Yeah, so I will open up the page and then you do the registration. Right, so I started with some story to tell you what you are supposed to do. I'm going to end this module with another story, okay? I maybe have said this before. Have control of your own life, okay? Don't let others control you, or don't give your life to other people to control you. So we have these students long time ago, 1994, 95 or something like that. Yeah, he believed in fortune telling. Like every year before or every semester before exam, he will go to this temple in Victoria Street. Si Ma Lu, you know, there's a temple down there. And in front of the temple, there sits a guy, not shaking leg, but look at others and palm, and then read the palm for them, right? So this student will go there, and of course, this guy will ask him questions. Okay, how do you do this semester? You know, how many modules you take? You know, a lot of questions. Right, then this guy asks, will I pass everything? Okay, so this guy, listen to what he say, you know, I have problem with 10-20. Of course, that time no 10-20. So this guy predicted that he's going to fail one module this semester after looking at his time. So this guy believed, he strongly believed. So he go back and think, okay, which module I'm going to fail? Most likely 10-20. So he stopped revising 10-20. He feel that if I'm going to fail already, because this guy say I'm going to fail 10-20, I won't waste my time to do it, right? I can spend more time on other modules. Of course, when he come out, he failed 10-20. Then he go around and tell people, wow, this guy very soon. You know, this is self-defeating, right? Before even you start, you already tell yourself you're going to fail. You are putting your life in someone else's hand. Okay, don't do that. Control your life. Okay, don't ask for mercy, as I said at the beginning, right? You have your total control. You do not need to ask for mercy. Please pass me and kind of thing. Okay, control yourself. Control your life. Have full control of it. Don't go and get people to read your life and so on. Help others. Okay, so there's this phrase that say it is better to help, to give than to receive. I don't know whether you believe or not. Okay, the idea is if you can give, that means you must be better than the other, right? Then you can give, right? Okay, if you have to receive from others, that means you are begging for help, as I say. So it's try to give, okay? So the idea is when you give, you see that there are other people are happy after they receive your help. In terms of school down here, you know, there are a lot of people who are weaker than you, who have problems struggling with their study. If you can help, why not you help them, okay? I know that sometimes this guy is preventing people from helping each other. Help others if possible. And actually, you can also help in other way, like, you know, there are a lot of natural disaster and all those kind of things, right? So previously, when there was this Philippines typhoon or something like that, we actually organized fundraising. The student will contribute and then we send the check to Red Cross. So whatever, you know, when you see a opportunity to help, do it. Okay, so the all the best for your exam. We still will see each other during the help session if you come. But otherwise, all the best. Okay, hopefully I don't see you next semester. Okay, thank you.